Oh, yes. Yeah, it's getting warmer. It's got like three different settings. I don't even use half that stuff. That was actually a present. That was actually a gift, a present, that lens. I have a cousin they just don't want anymore.
Well, welcome everybody to the first full day of almost heaven's star party. I hope you saw some photons last night. Unfortunately, it wasn't as good as what we had on the setup crew on Thursday night. We had a beautiful night. But it looks like the weather's going to improve for the rest of the weekend. Our speaker this morning is John Sojka, who works in an agency which shall not be named, but you can sneak up and read his shirt. Maybe you'll figure out what it is.
It's a couple agencies. Hmm? It's a couple. This is the old one.
This is his cousin. He's been working in and around optics and photography for quite a while, advising his government employers and doing photography for his own interests. He's going to talk to us this morning about introductory astrophotography. I've heard him speak on this topic before. He's a friend of Novak. He's a member of Novak. He has a quite comprehensive view of what amateurs can start doing and what they can move into, and we thought it would be a good, almost keynote speech for this weekend, give you some motivation to what you can try, assuming you have some of the equipment with you beyond looking through your eyepiece. So with that, I'll introduce John.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jeff.
Thank you very much. Thank you. So that's the introduction. I found this slide, and it's really apropos. What society thinks I do, what my mom thinks I do, and then finally what my friends think I do, or what society is. But this is the truth. If anybody's done astrophotography before or astroimaging, this is what it's really it's all about. I wanted to ask before I got started, how many people here are just starting out with astrophotography and astroimaging? Good number of you. How many would say they're intermediate? Don't be shy. And experts, is anybody experts here? Bob? Okay. All right, so I try to make the slide so it's 60% beginner, maybe 30% intermediate, and 10% advanced to try to cover the bases. It's just the agenda, hardware. I just wanted to, if you're just starting out and you're here for the first time and you're like, what kind of hardware should I get? What's my first equipment do I want to use to get started? I don't want to spend too much money. I mean, when I first got started in this, I didn't want to spend too much money, but it became very addictive. So I'm now in this upward band here. But if you're just beginning, you want at least get a reflector that's 6 inches, a reflector that's 6 inches or greater. Ideally, you want to have something like 10, but that's for more advanced. But if you just want to get started, you want to take some pictures of Jupiter, you want to take some pictures of Saturn, things like that, and some nebula. This is a great start for between 800 about 1500. You can get yourself a refractor. You do not want something from Toys R Us or Kmart with the plastic lenses. You want to get something that's real. Mount, you can get away with a Dobsonian Alt Azimuth, or if you want to jump right into equatorial and fork with the wedge, go right ahead. One of the first questions people ask is, what kind of camera should I get? I will get to that in a second, but any DSLR will work. So if you have a Canon that dates back to 1995, it will work. If it's 8 megapixels, it's fine. The first images out there that are some of the best were taken with old cameras. Or you can get yourself a planetary camera. It's basically a fancy webcam, and those are pretty inexpensive. And then as you get into more advanced, you definitely want to get 8 inches or greater as a reflector, 5 inches APO refractor, just in case you don't know. And an APO triplet has 3 lenses in it, and it accounts for red, green, and blue, where an achromat really just accounts for red and blue, and the green is just a little bit off. It's fine for observation, but it's not good for deep space astrophotography because you'll get some blur and some separation of colors. Mount, you're definitely, if you want to do advanced stuff, you're going to have to get an equatorial. That's what this is. I'll give an example in a second. Or you want to fork with the wedge. And there's reasons that you need those mounts. And you cannot go with the Dobsonian. And I'll show why in the brief. And then a camera, you either want to get a modified hydrogen alpha DSLR camera. And what that basically does is you send in your DSLR camera. And there's a couple places out there. One is called UTech. There's a few more companies out there. They actually modify the filters in your camera to get more of the hydrogen alpha red light that's near the infrared spectrum. Most of the nebula out there, so this is the reason why, most of the nebula that are out there are emitting in hydrogen alpha. That's, I won't go into the physics of it, but when, I guess I have to maybe, you know, when the hydrogen atom becomes, it's not ionized, that's the proper word, like I am right now. When the electron gets hit by a particle or some type of energy, it jumps a shell. Now, we all heard about that in high school. But then it goes back down. But to release the energy, it has to release it some way. And guess what? It's emitting a photon at a specific wavelength of light that we call hydrogen alpha. So that's the reason for it. I hope that was clear. So, for those that are beginners, I said I was going to start with beginners if you've never done this before. Ideally, obviously, you want cool, you know, right there on the left side, clear, cool, dark, dry, and a stable atmosphere. I mean, those are what you need, period. So what you don't want, matter of fact, these top three, you can pretty much just go home or not even go out. So this goes from worst to, like, least worst. So when it's overcast, obviously we just learned about this, you really can't image. Some people actually will ask me, can a telescope cut through the atmosphere? Can it cut through the clouds? And the truth is no. If your eye can't see it, the telescope's not going to see it. Now maybe it could see a tiny bit more, but most of the time not. So it's not even worth going out. So when I step outside to do my astrophotography and it's overcast, I don't even hesitate. I just go right back in. It's not even worth it. When you now know what wind can do to astrophotographs, I think you know by last night. When I first started out, I wanted to see if I could do it, and I got blurs. I got constant blurs, so it's just useless. So if it's windy, if it's more than 15 miles per hour, just go back home. Moon, when I'm doing astrophotography and people come up to me, they go, oh my God, the moon is out tonight, it's a beautiful night. I'm like, oh no, the moon is the enemy. Yeah. Unless you're shooting the moon is your enemy. So if you really want to do astrophotography or astroimaging, you don't want the moon out. If you want to get nebula, if you want galaxies, if you want that real rich stuff, you can't have the moon out. There's filters and stuff, but you really don't want the moon out. So important thing is that Novak has this day, the Almost Heaven, I don't know if Novak runs this. Okay, has the Almost Heaven Star Party when there's a new moon, when there's no moon. So they actually plan this so that you can do your imaging and best seeing when there's no moon. Sky glow. So if you are near a city, I'm saying that this goes from worst, I guess, least worst. But sky glow, you don't want to be near a city because when you image, you'll start to capture all this glow from the city. And then if there's some clouds up there, you get reflection back and it washes out your image. So there are filters that can help with that. So you can start to image if there's some sky glow. Heat is not your friend. That's why you got to wait for your telescope to cool off. You want it to reach the ambient temperature of the outside. You don't want to stick, so I made the mistake of this a long time ago and I won't do it again, was sticking a hand warmer into the sleeve for my refractor, and I just got distortion, so you don't want to do that. Humidity is also not your friend. We all know what dew can do to pictures. So if you witness these top three, just go home. These bottom three, there's ways to cope. But those are the conditions for beginners, in case you're just wondering. This is very important. Get back to here. Again, for the beginner, just point to this top thing. So when I first got started, I didn't know which way to image. Can I image something just over the horizon? Look at Saturn yesterday. It was about maybe 10 to 20 degrees just above the horizon. I now know that I would not image that. So why wouldn't you? So if you image something that's straight up, you're cutting through one atmosphere straight up. You know, so So if you include particulates, light reflection, humidity, all that kind of distortion, you only have to cut through one atmosphere. As you go more at an angle, as you can see here, 1 year mass, 1.2 year mass is 1.4, 3.9, and so on. So you're cutting through 3 to 4 times as much air to get an object that's over here. So for any beginners, if you look through a telescope at something that's low on the horizon, you will see why. Somebody actually came up to me and says, why is Saturn red, green, and blue? I said, well, it's atmospheric distortion. It's called diffraction. So if you want some good imaging, you basically want to begin to image maybe at 30 degrees and higher. So just go like this, and if it's below your hand, forget it. If it's above, it's probably worth doing. Are there any questions with that? It's pretty clear, I think, right? All right, cameras. Okay, so you can get started with planetary cameras. I've seen in between $50 to $500. DSLRs ranging between $400 to $2,000. Like I said, you can get a Canon, you know, like a 20DA, I think those were back then. And what do those run for? $500, $600, $800? Yeah. Or, okay, in the thousands, but yeah, so you can buy used. You can get a decent camera for $500, as high as probably be more than $2,000. But you can get a good camera for $2,000. Then you start getting into dedicated deep space CCD cameras, and those can run you a ton of money. But they grasp the images quicker. They're cooled, and I'll go into why that's important in a second. But once you This is actually, so this is from beginner to more advanced. You think you're gonna start here, but once you enjoy it and it gets good, you're gonna find yourself working up that ladder. All right. What's important when selecting a camera is its chip size. So I'm having a hard time with this. So in the middle here is your typical low-end smartphone camera. So if you were to hold up your smartphone camera up to an eyepiece and try to take a picture, you'd get something about this big. Now, if you go online and you look at catalogs for Sony, Olympus, Nikon, Canon, you'll see that quite often they're APS-C size chips and APS-H size chips. And there's some that are in between here, but they're not capturing the full image like they could. They're not a full frame camera here, which I'll explain right here. So if you have something that's called a full frame 36 millimeter camera, that gives you the same view as this 36 millimeter camera, film cameras back in the day. So if you can, go for this. They're more expensive, but you're definitely gonna get more area. Any questions with that? It's pretty simple. All right, so, how do I hook up my camera? A lot of people are amazed that you can hook up a camera to a telescope. And it's really not that amazing. You really need two pieces. One is you need the T adapter and the T ring. And really quickly, I have one right here. So this part here in front here is the T ring. That's a separate piece. And you get the T rings for Nikon. You get it for an Olympus. I mean, they're brand specific for a Canon. So I got the Canon T ring. And then you get the T adapter, which screws into here. And it actually goes, so then this, actually, I might as well just show you as I'm talking. So I'm just going to show you some things here. Spend too much time. Shouldn't be too hard. Of course, I'm not going to be able to do this fast enough. Let me just pop this out. So this is pretty much the basics. You just take the camera housing with the T adapter for your specific camera, and now that just snaps in place. And that actually goes into your focuser. And you can focus through the diopter, or you can focus through the rear end of the camera. So it's not that difficult. Oh, I should probably be back up here. Just one more. So any astrophotographer, at least I would argue with you, recommends prime focus. It's the easiest. It actually turns your entire telescope into a telephoto lens, where you do this afocal, where you're adding these elements in between eyepieces, Barlows, and things like that. But as you begin to do that, the housing gets really long, and then you put it into the back of your telescope, and it begins to warp and bend, and it just makes for a big headache. So I recommend the prime focus. For beginners, again, when I first got my camera, I asked the questions, well, what should my camera settings be? I have no knowledge of what I should do with this. So through many book readings and many mentors and much experience, I can tell you this is a good place to start. You want to set your camera to manual or bulb. ISO is an 800. That's a good start. I mean, so there's reasons to go lower and sometimes reasons to go higher. But if you're just starting out and you don't know what you're doing, that's a good start. White balance auto, your auto rotate off, autofocus off. When you do astrophotography, turn off the autofocus on your lenses, on your camera. You can't autofocus. You're going to have to manually focus. The image format, you always want it to be raw if you can help it, because when you shoot a raw image, it collects all the data from the image that you're taking. So if it was a JPEG, there might be some loss of data, right? Because it's a compression loss. It's a lossless versus loss format, right? Yeah. So you want mirror flip function. Why would I want a mirror flip function? Who would understand why?
Vibrate the camera.
Yeah. So when you're taking a picture, don't forget that when you hit the shutter, your camera shakes just a little bit, and guess what? You just blurred your stars. So what you want to do is, so if you turn on the mirror flip function on your camera, you hit it, and you actually hear the mirror flip upward, and then you image. But it gets to a point where you don't even have to use your finger. You can use an intervalometer, which I'll get to in a second. But you always want mirror flip. Long exposure noise reduction. I know they're on Nikons for sure, and I also know that they're on Canons. You may not know what's happening behind the scenes, but that's why I'm here to tell you, is if you take a picture that's, let's say it's 3 minutes, and you have this function turned on, it'll take the picture, then it closes the shutter, then it takes another picture for 3 minutes with the shutter closed, so it's dark. But what it's really doing is it's collecting the noise that's in your camera, and it subtracts it from that image, giving you a new image that's clear. Now, I recommend it for 3 minutes or less, because reasonably when we're asked to do an astro-imaging, we can manage, I think for me, mentally 3 minutes for each picture. But if you're doing 5 minutes per picture or 10 minutes per picture, guess what? Your 10-minute picture just turned into a 20-minute picture for a single picture. I'm not going to do that. So what I do, which I'll explain in a moment, is I take all my pictures and I take something called darks at the very end. And that's where you put the cap back on the camera so it's dark, and then you just take your darks as you're driving home or as you're packing up your tent. And you just take darks after darks after darks. And then there's software that you say, okay, here's my pictures and here's my darks. After the fact, subtract my darks from my lights to give me new pictures. You're giving me a look like, you already know about that, I think. Okay. Accessories, I will tell you, they are must-haves. I try to get away with doing things where I would do the mirror flip, then I would do a timer. So 10 seconds, it gave me 10 seconds to stop the vibration of my camera after I hit the switch. But you know what? It's just aggravating. I want to be able to have a cup of coffee and talk to my colleagues. So intervalometers, you can set up how long you want to expose for, the intervals between each, and how many pictures you want to take. So I'll say, please give me 21 pictures of this area of space, only 2 seconds in between, and for exposures of 5 minutes. And it just rock and rolls for me. And I don't have to stand there and keep pressing it. The other thing you'll need, so this should be like the grandfather of all astral imaging slides. The Batonov mask, if you're going to focus on galaxies and nebula. So when I first got started, I was trying to eyeball a nebula. I mean, how are we supposed to take a picture of a nebula? I was totally confused. And somebody said, well, focus on a star and then swing it over to the nebula. You want to focus in infinity. I was like, okay, so I went over there and set it to infinity. But even when I went towards the nebula, my pictures weren't always that crisp. Then my mentor there, Bob Traub, he said, what you need to get yourself is a Batonov mask. Now, I had so much pride, I didn't want to tell him that behind his back I went on and I bought one. And I set it up. And this is what you get for your money. So if you're too far left in your focus, this line here will start to move left. And then as you bring it back, it'll go, you know, like too far right. But when you get this perfect X on a star, You are focused perfectly at infinity for that telescope setup. And now, don't touch anything. You just lock everything. You swing your telescope towards the nebula that you want to image, and it'll come out crisp and clear. Works every time. One drawback. I know everybody knows where we're going with this. How many people have not taken a... Right, so thank you, Bob, but I know that most of you have forgotten. So at some point, you will image for 2 hours. You're like, I got all these great pictures on this clear night, and it's just starting to get cloudy, but I got all my pictures. And then you realize, I left on my Batinoff mask. And all your stars are X's, and it's not as clear as it can be. So I just offer this hint of experience. The Batinoff attaches by one screw, by three screws. I just do one screw. I hang it from the top of my telescope. So when I swing it to my target, it falls off because it rotates, and then it just falls off. I go, oh my God, it fell to the ground. I would have forgot that. So try it. All right. So in the beginning astrophotography realm, let's get started here. I was speaking, your name is Richard. We're having lunch. He says, I want to do astrophotography, but I hate all of the telescope stuff, the wires and all that kind of stuff, and stuff that takes hours to set up. So if you want to take something, a picture of a Milky Way, you can use any mount. Doesn't matter. It doesn't even have to be automated. Any camera, basically, as long as you can change the ISO settings. So some of your cameras, your handhelds, should be able to work. Best lenses to use, if you have them, is f1.5 speed to f3. And you want something that's 15 to 30 millimeter for wide area. So if you just basically look at your lens here, you know, there's numbers on it. And so this one is a variable lens. So I can go as low as to 28. So I got this big monster lens. This is actually too big for the Milky Way. I got to bring it all the way down to 28 millimeters if I'm going to do a Milky Way shot that looks like this. So your cameras should be able to do a wonderful job. And you know, just why I got a few seconds here. I'm sorry to screw this in anyway. I think I got it too tight before. And I'm actually going to need this in a slide that's coming up, so that's why I'm going through with this. So I can reattach the camera after the fact.
So isn't the tube after replacing the lens?
Oh yeah, it does, but when I do the T-adapter, so I don't want to mislead you. The T-adapter is for telescopes. So you use that to connect to a telescope. So in essence, this is a mini telescope, really. Yeah, so that's nice and tight. So you really don't need a telescope to take just pictures of the Milky Way. So I was asked, how can I get started tonight if I don't have anything? If you don't have a mount, just like use a book and just point your camera towards the Milky Way overhead. And what's really important is, let me just go back here. Yeah. You don't need anything. What's important is that you don't touch it. So then one of the questions is, how long do I expose this for? 10 minutes, 5 minutes? How do I capture the Milky Way? So there's something called the 500 rule. I explained it here, but is there somebody that wants to point out like what it is? Anybody? Does anybody know what it is? Okay. So you take 500 and you divide it by the focal length of your lens. So if you dig into your bag and you got a lens that's 35 millimeters, you divide 500 by 35, and that gives you the seconds that you need to expose for. It's as simple as that. It's something you can just do in your head. So if you have something that's a 20 millimeter lens, you divide 500 by the number that's on your lens, and it's 25 seconds. So I did this computation last night. I pointed it at the Milky with this lens, and I imaged for 30 seconds, which is what I computed, and I got crisp, clear shots. So recommend a remote switch or the timer to prevent vibration. So if you just want to take your picture, you know, boop, boop, and then it'll count down and take your picture, but at least you're no longer touching it to vibrate it. Point at the Milky Way, you focus at infinity. We all know how to focus on infinity? Everybody? No? So on your lens, there's something that looks like a figure eight. So you want to turn to that. That's the infinity. So when something gets so far beyond a certain point, the focusing on something that is one light year is no different from something that's at 100 light years. Okay, so at that point, I mean, you're just at infinity forever. So you just want to focus on forever, so to speak, and then you could take those pictures. So all stars, all nebula. Oh, and I just wanted to point out this bundle. So I am not endorsing Orion, but they got this bundle I saw for sale for $179. It's a tripod, and it actually has a motor on it for $179. You just can't go wrong. So if you want to get started quick, go ahead.
I read, you know, online, obviously you can find anything you want, but
yeah.
It's that don't focus at infinity, but back it off.
So, funny you that you asked me that. So I actually read up on this just before I came up here, because in case a question like that came up. So some cameras are designed, so the truth is you do focus on infinity, okay? And the other side of the coin is sometimes you have to go slightly past infinity. With this lens, because it's a variable lens, you sometimes it has different infinities for different focal lengths, all right? But also sometimes the infinity is not perfectly set too, so that's why you sort of sometimes have to eyeball it. But pretty much if you're taking a picture of the Milky Way, it doesn't have to be perfect. Put it to the little infinity symbol, take the picture for the computed amount of time, do the computation in your head, that's it. And you will get this. You will get this amazing type of picture. No, that's not going to affect your the exposure time's the same. Yeah, you just get a smaller image.
Okay.
Yeah, or it's a more cropped image. That's the proper way to say it. All right, any more questions here? It's pretty straightforward. It's something that you can do tonight. Sometimes they'll do 600 rule if it's darker. So if it's 600, it means you can image for a few more seconds. And actually, the real reason for the 500 or 600 rule is this. Anything past that 25 seconds for this 20 millimeter lens is so you don't get star trailing. That's the real reason. You can expose for longer just fine, but then your stars are going to be oblong and not round. So that's the real reason behind it. Speaking of star trails, let's get to this. For the beginner, this is something that that you can do right now. Any mount, any camera, set your ISO between 400 to 600. Focus on Polaris, which is the North Star, again, on infinity. Optional interferometer, because you can get through, well, it is optional, but you are going to want it, because you're not going to want to come back in 5 minutes and take another picture, walk away, and wait 5 minutes to come back. You just want to set up your interferometer to just image. If you wanted to, you could expose for 2 hours and get all sorts of motion, but you could start to burn out your chip and you'll overexpose. So it's recommended to do it about 5 minutes and do like a 2 hour exposure, and you'll get something that's very close to this. Now, I got to give props to this picture. This was taken, I believe, at the Almost Heaven Star Party last year. I couldn't give credit online because I don't know who posted the picture, but I do want to do it publicly. Somebody from here took this picture. So, are there any questions? Oh, then expose. Oh, very important. You don't wait more than 5 seconds between your next shot, because you'll start to see gaps in your image. If you want a solid star trail, you don't want to wait more than 5 seconds. So the intervalometer again comes into play. You want to get one of those. Don't move the camera, and then you're going to have all these different pictures with star motion, and you can combine them in Photoshop. And there's some free tools, Star Trails Action and Star Trails. You just look those up, or just do a Google search for combining star trail images, and you'll.
Question about this one. Is there a particular time of night that's best to do this within, so that you don't get sunset and sunrise?
So again, I'm staying here for 2 hours. If you want to try to go the night, obviously you're not going to get a complete circle, because that's 24 hours and. So 12 hours at most, 8 hours. If you wanted to, I'd recommend at sunset and an hour afterward. Yeah. Yeah, probably about an hour and a half or something like that. But you know, I actually noticed when I'm out in the field, for what this is worth, is there's a period where people are still up and they're turning and their lights for their houses are still up, okay? But 2, 3, 4 in the morning, everybody's sleeping. So the only lights that are on are like parking lots and office buildings or something. So I start to find about 2 a.m., like between 2 and 5 or something.
What keeps you on the same image without advancing to another picture? Is it setting it on manual? Or?
Without advancing to another image?
Yeah, because like a regular camera, when you click it, it goes to the next picture, the next picture, the next picture. What keeps it on that same picture?
So what's happening is you take a picture, all right, and then it gets done. It waits 5 seconds, takes a picture of the same space again, and you just keep doing it all night long. Then what happens is your stars are like this, and then you combine them in one of these applications to make one picture. Yeah, very simple, actually. There's no mystery in it, but in fact, there's stuff online on how to do star trails. Very simple. Is there another question?
What kind of aperture do you suggest?
I would say about the same amount as for the Milky Way. Anything 30, 20, 30, 50 maybe. I'm going to go any higher than that because it starts to get smaller. Yeah. Yeah. Let's just say that you increase your aperture to something like 50 or 80 or something like that. So then what's going to happen is you're going to capture this circle. You follow me?
Yeah, but like if I
Mm-hmm. That's great. That's perfect. So, real quickly, Dobsonian for part of beginning astroimaging. This happened for me. So when I first got started in astroimaging, I said I'm going to get myself a big telescope that could take great pictures, deep space, and all this other kind of stuff. But I was fooled because I didn't do my research. But I'm still glad that I bought it. I bought a Dobsonian. It's great for the moon. It's great for a variety of stuff. You can still do the Milky Way. You can still do star trails. But I'll explain the limitation in a moment. All planetary, because when you take your planetary images, you don't take images, you take video. And I'll explain how that's done in a moment. But your ISO settings will range between 100 to 3200, and I'll explain in the following slide why that is, why there's this big gap. Deep space objects with a magnitude of 8 or less. So why this magnitude of 8 or less? So something like Orion, the Orion Nebula, I believe it's like a 7. I don't know if I want to double check on that. So if I were to set my ISO to 1600 or something like that and point it at Orion for about 30 seconds, you will get an image. You definitely will. And you won't get a whole lot of smearing with stars. But just so you know, if you go for too long with a Dobsonian, you will get star smear, and I'll explain why in a moment. And once again, so for planets and any deep space objects, so if you're looking up a deep space object online, said I want to image the Ring Nebula, and it's like, oh, it's got a magnitude of like 10. I think I might want to keep away from that because by the time I image it, it's going to be blurry. And so planetary imaging, this is what you do if you want to take a picture of this. This is some good stuff. You want to use a PowerMate or a Barlow for planets only. You don't want to do this for anything else. Planets are not so much affected by the Barlows because they're in the center. But you do need to blow up your planets because if you don't, they'll just look like a dime. So you want to manual focus through live view or your diopter of your camera. You really can't use the Batinov mask. Some people say you can if you know what you're looking for. I still haven't found what I'm looking for, so to speak. But what I do know is you can eyeball it because planets are very close to but not at infinity like stars are. So there is a little bit of focus play when it comes to planets. So you want to look on the back of your camera with live view, or you want to look through the diopter, get it nice and sharp, and then lock it in. Set your white balance to auto. Shoot videos between 10 to 30 seconds. So when you're doing planets, so for example, this is a picture of Jupiter that I took, that's in back of there. This projector is not really doing it justice, but what you do is there's the most famous tool. Some people would say there might be better tools, but there's a free tool called Registax. I think the current version is 6.0 or 6 point something. What that does is it'll take your 10 seconds of planetary video. So you get your telescope on it, you do a video recording, count down 10, 20 seconds, and then stop, and do that a couple times. But then what you do is you bring it into Registax, and it lists the frames like a movie slide, and you can go through all the frames real fast, and then you find out and you choose a frame that is the best frame that you can visually eyeball of the planet you just took, because as you go through the frames, you'll see atmospheric distortion, it'll get better, get worse, and you go, ah, there's a great frame right here. You mark that as your base frame, and then what Registax lets you do is then sort them. So it takes what you perceive to be as the best frame, it sticks it at the front, and then it lists, for lack of a better phrase, best to worst frames. And then what you want to do is, out of these 4,000 frames that I just took, give me the top 100, which is, you know, the top 1% or 2% or whatever, and then stack those. And then the software will actually take each frame and move it and stack it for you. And then as you do that, it gets richer, there's more color, it's clearer, it's more crisp. And then there's some tools that you can play with that start to really bring in the image. And quite frankly, a tool for me works great. I sometimes bring it into Photoshop just to clean up just a little bit, but you'll be amazed what Registax can do for you. Are there any questions about this slide?
What would you clean up in Photoshop?
So for example, there is noise in video. So a lot of times, if you bring up the histogram, in front of the histogram, there's all this noise that's at the beginning, and you just want to get rid of all that. And then it makes your picture dark. Then what you can do is up the saturation. So these are keywords, your saturation, your vibrance, your contrast. And as you move the saturation, it's kind of hard to see here because of the projector. But things like the great red spot, the storm, really starts to come in. Yeah. So for things like that. And you know what? Just play with it, and you'll start to discover what's working for you. Any more?
So for 30 seconds, you can do that on the dot.
Yeah. That's why I said this. So this is, Adobe can do all planetary. Yeah. And here's what I was talking about the ISO settings. Very important. Very important. When you look at Mercury or you look at Venus and say your ISO setting for your video is 800, it's going to be just white and blurred out, or it's overexposed. So what you start to discover is, if I'm going to image something like Mercury or Venus, my ISO setting should be about 100. Then when you start doing like Mars and Jupiter, it's about two to 400. As you get out to Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune, then you start going up to 1600 to 3200. And I got very good shots with that. So you do want to increase your ISO the further you go out from the sun with the planets. That's probably the best way to explain it. All right. In my mind's eye, separating beginner astrophotography from advanced starts with this thing called rotation. And by looking at this slide, who can see what the difference is? Who can see the difference in this? You're about to raise your hand? Are you talking about here?
Yes.
Okay. That's correct. So, perfect. I'm glad you stood up and you answered that question. So, this is what I was talking about with the motion blur. So, let's just say that you were doing an exposure. Don't forget that with a fork or a Dobsonian, it's imaging like this throughout the night. Okay? So, it is not, and things are, your deep space objects that are going across the sky are going across with an arc. So what does that mean for us? This is a picture of Orion that's holding the lion's mane. I always thought it was a shield. It's not. He's holding the lion's mane in front. He's got the slingshot in the back of him. But if you look here, this is actually pointing towards this upper corner here. This is pointing towards here. This is pointing towards the side now. So if you were doing it, and then it's pointing to this corner. And so as the Dobsonian would have tracked this overnight, you would get one big smear, because it's not rotating with the object. So it's the same thing, like if you're taking a picture of somebody's face, you need to move your mount as the face moves so that you don't get that blur. So that's where an equatorial mount comes in. So real quickly, you can kind of, probably don't even need to see it here. If you really want to do exposures for 1 hour, 2 hours throughout the night and not have to worry about it, you need to get yourself an equatorial telescope so that it rotates with the image. And the image is always in the same frame that's being imaged. So you can actually see it here. So as I image through something throughout the night, it's actually staying with the image on the rotation. Now, I think that's pretty clear. Any questions about that?
Or? I have a boardwall, and it has an equatorial mount.
Mm-hmm.
Would that give me the proper rotation?
What type of a?
An equatorial platform.
Yeah, I mean, if as long as it's equatorial, yes.
So or that would give me the proper rotation.
Yeah, and then if you don't have it, there's people that use these fork mounts. I'm not a pro with fork mounts, but you just set up the angle ahead of time, and you just go with the curve of the sky. You're gonna. That's what I was just telling him. I'm not really an expert with forks, but is there somebody in here who is? Bob.
What he's talking about is the platform that you set your Dodsonian on. The platform actually rotates.
Got you.
That's an equatorial mount effect.
That's fine.
What you're talking about is a rotator that fits in the back of your telescope, and it counteracts the rotation of the Earth.
Yeah, have you ever seen?
I've never used one, but I've heard that they do work well. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, some professional astrophotography, big telescopes, but I'm not positive.
Yeah, the setting up a wedge, you know, going portable, dark side set up a wedge, I commend all of you to do that.
So I do know that this exists. I personally wouldn't get it because if you're going to go through this headache, I would just buy a different mount. But I do know that even for a Dobsonian, they make something that goes between the between the focuser and the camera that rotates the camera. So
that's
oh, okay. So I am not.
But the Astro-imaging wouldn't have this to be at the right angle.
Yeah.
Yes. Or under the main.
Mm-hmm. But you still need that motor. No, because as you're doing the imaging, don't forget you're exposing for 5 minutes, and in that 5 minutes there's blur now. That's after the fact, yeah. If it was just a snapshot, then sure, but you're not doing a snapshot, you're doing a long-term exposure. A planet is fine because the way it stacks and it uses video, and the software will actually move the planet around and do all this kind of stuff, but for this kind of stuff, if you take a 10, 5, 10, 8, 10, minute exposure of a deep space object, it'll be one big blur. Yeah.
I talked to a guy that actually sold him, and he said the fork mounts, long exposure, they're not good because it adds more complexity, more things that you have to worry about, more things that you don't want. So he's like, no, just buy it. So,
equatorial. Yeah.
It's less hassle.
Mm-hmm. The problem is I think that people buy this stuff to get started and go, I'll just add on to that instead of buying a. So when people ask me, what kind of beginner telescope should I get? I'm thinking about getting an 8-inch Newtonian. I go, if you can afford an 8, pay the $200 more for a 10 because there's something called mirror fever, aperture fever. So you might as well just go big. And it's the same thing with the fork. I mean, with the equatorial mount. You know, if you're going to spend $800 for a mount and then later on you're going to want to buy a mount that's $1,500, you just spent $800 and $1,500, so now you just spent $2,300 or $2,200. So, just if you could pony up front, go ahead. Astro-imaging equipment. So this is what you need to do. So I don't know if you've been paying attention, but the images in the background have all been images that I've taken with basically this mount right here. So if you want to do exposures that go for hours, but you don't take hours worth of, you break it down into maybe 5, 10, 15 minutes for a couple hours, and then you stack them. But this is what you're going to need. So if you want a list really quick of the stuff that you will need, equatorial mount, you're going to need an auto guider. You want to get an S-Big. It doesn't have to be an S-Big, but some type of CCD camera, a modified hydrogen alpha DSLR. High-res mono cameras are pretty big too with the color wheels. I don't know if you people want to do this. This really gets into complex stuff, but some people will image an area in red, then they switch it out and they image it in blue, then they image it in green, and then they combine at the end. Produces great photos. I don't know if I've reached that point with spending all that time, but okay. Imaging scope, you're going to want an APO. I think I explained before why you don't want an achromatic because of it doesn't align all the colors, but the APO does. You want a refractor of 8 inches or greater. And there's this thing called the focal length or the focal ratio, F7 or less. people probably wonder, well, you know, an F8, F10, all those give me better magnification. Well, yes. So as you increase your focal ratio, you get more detailed at greater magnification, but it takes longer to image that stuff. So the shorter the, you were asking me about that lens you had, that was like a F3 or something like that, F3 you said?
Oh, I was kind of like
F3. Yeah, oh, okay. So you want to capture light quickly and start to get that image, or else you're going to be out there all night. So if you get a big telescope that's F12, it's probably not good for astro imaging. Remote timer switch is basically or your intervalometer. You want something like Photoshop or comparable software program. Just basically the things that do saturation, vibrance, contrast, brightness, that allows you to make an S-curve, which I'll give an example of in a second. Extra batteries, you're going to want extra batteries. I can't tell you how many times throughout the night that my battery went dead or it was cold, so it sucked the life out of it, and I just put in a new one. You're going to want batteries. You don't want to come out here set up just to find out it all stopped that night because you didn't have batteries. So stock up on batteries. If you want, when you take pictures with either Dobsonian or Newtonian, rather, or refractor, you're going to want a field flattener or a focal reducer. You're going to want a field flattener. So with a lot of refractors, towards the ends, you will start to see some, especially on Dobsonians too, you will start to see towards the ends this vignetting where your stars are being elongated. If you want to get rid of that, there's something you put in between called a field flattener, and it squeezes those stars at the corners back together. Filters. These are probably the most important filters. If you're going to spend, if you're standing there or you're about to buy some filters because you want to do great astrophotography, you're thinking to yourself, what filters should I get? So what these are, something called bypass filters. These aren't filtering hydrogen alpha, hydrogen beta, oxygen 3, and sulfur 2. What these are doing, they're bypass filters. They block all other light except for hydrogen alpha, hydrogen beta. So if you want to, you can go onto a NASA website, Wikipedia, look up a nebula, and if it says, well, this nebula is emitting hydrogen alpha, first thing you do is you screw in your hydrogen alpha filter, you point it at that object, and it'll block out all the ambient light from street lights and things like that. Now, I will endorse, this is just me personally, a brand called Lumicon, and I bought one called a deep sky filter. I just wanted to give it a try. I heard some good things about it. And for whatever reason, it is able to block out all ambient light except like these top three. And I'm like, this is great. So when I take some pictures, and I could probably show you some pictures later where my images are just astounding because they're so crisp and clear. The only light they're letting through are those wavelengths that that nebula is emitting. So dew heaters, hand warmers, you're probably learning fast what dew can do to your equipment. Your lens will start to do over. You don't want to have that happen. So you can do a couple things. You could buy a dew heater. I'm a fan of hand warmers. I just buy the ones you have for skiing, and I tape those around my primary area, my secondary area, and some key parts of my equipment. And they work just fine, and they last the night. And they're pretty cheap, so. What kind of imagery can I do with the equatorial mount, with tracking, and an autoguider? So I think I've already said this. The Milky Way, of course, star trails, all planetary, no problem. All deep sky objects, there's not one you'll have a problem with. You could take a few seconds to hours of imaging time and not have to worry about it because it's tracking with the object. But you do need that autoguider. I'll explain that in a second. And recommended ISO setting 800 or less, because you're doing long exposure photography. You don't need to capture something quick with the higher ISO. So in case a lot of you don't know, ISO just amplifies the light that you're already taking in, but it's doing it over a shorter period, a shorter sampling. So if you decrease your ISO, it's not amplifying what it's getting over a shorter period. It's taking more true data, and you get crisper pictures, clearer pictures, more rich pictures. So when you're doing advanced, try to go to the lowest ISO possible, but there is a sweet spot, which I'll get to. What are my steps? Use your Batinoff. So this, if you want to take something out of your Orion Nebula or something that's out there, Use a Batinoff mask to focus, camera mirror with the flip-up function or remote switch, we now know, to prevent the vibration. ISO setting of 800 with the white balance of auto. 5-minute exposure time is a great place to start. A lot of people like ask, where do I start? Do I do it 10 minutes, 2 minutes? Deep space objects, start about 5 minutes. And we'll show you how that can be adjusted when you need to. You want to take, I could go into details, but I'll try to skip that. Take at least 21 light images, which is the image that, or the target that you're imaging. Those are referred to as light images. So you open a book on astroimaging, that's what a light image is. At least 9 to 12 dark frames, which I said are used later to remove the noise from the pictures that you just took. So who knows what a dark frame is? Got that? You want to? Yeah, and then you remove that, so. You can't because your temperature does change, your humidity changes. Oh yeah, big time. Or if you've been imaging for 5 minutes, your camera is a lot cooler than one that's been imaging for 2 hours. The chip just gets hot. That's why those CCD cameras that are expensive, they have internal cooling, yeah. As the camera heats up, it creates more noise. It creates its heat noise, and it gets terrible. So I mentioned earlier in the brief that if you're doing 3 minutes, I recommend it just set up your camera so it does it at the time that your picture is being taken. But then you have to wait for twice the amount of time. Who asked that question? Was it? I'm sorry. But what you want to do is, as soon as you're done at the end of the night, and you're putting away your equipment and stuff, just put the camera lens on it and just start taking darks. Just start. You don't want to wait too long and get home because the camera's cooled off. It's in your house. There's less humidity. Do you follow me? So you want to try to capture your darks immediately after you take your light frames.
Sure.
No. You know what, I realize I didn't point this out. If your light frame is a 5 minute exposure, your dark frame is for a 5 minute exposure. Now I know I said the camera kinda, that when it's on autopilot, that's what it does, but then if you do it manually, you gotta remember to manually put the cap on and take 5 minute pictures with the cap on. Flat frames, who knows what a flat frame is?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, absolutely, that's absolutely correct. What this means to you is, when you take a picture, you're definitely, if you had no flat frames and you were using especially something like a focal reducer, you're going to get this tunnel vision of your image where it's darker on the outside, but it's more light on the inside. And as a matter of fact, I think this picture might even have a little bit of that. If you want to create a uniform flat picture where all the colors are even, you take this thing called a flat frame. And so that's where you put the white, some kind of a t-shirt or a piece of paper or something, you point it into an empty space of sky, and you image for a period of time, which I'll explain to later, so that you create an inverse, so to speak, where it's darker in the middle, but you know, it actually just creates one flat light, yeah. So it creates one uniform white, and then that is used later by software to make your image very flat and get rid of the tunnel vision, which I think I'll go to in a second. Your bias frames, that is just where you set your camera to the fastest speed possible. So for a lot of people, I think that's 4,000 or 8,000. Right, and you just take a bunch of bias frames, and that records the base of what my camera is, so to speak. So that, I guess that's the best way. It captures the static and all the mistakes and the bias and the base of what your camera is, and that is actually using the equation of cleaning up your image. I do it. So just before I take my dark frames and my camera's still hot, I stick the lens on. I go. And I take about 10 of those real quick, and I'm done with my bias frames. and then I go on to my
lens cap on.
On. The only ones where the lens cap, well, the two with the lens cap off is your white or your flat frames, and when you're taking light, you're at your actual target. But bias and dark frames are with cap on. Well, there might be some arguments here, but if you're pretty darn sure you haven't moved, if you're always taking your camera and at the same angle on your telescope, and maybe you put a little notch, I would argue you could, and maybe there might be some variations that are almost not noticeable. Some guys feel they need to create their lights with every, go on, Bob.
The other factor that flat's taking are any dust that's gotten on your sensor.
That's right.
So
yeah, so yeah, if there's dust on your picture, or like insects, or aircraft that fly through, or satellites. If you take a bunch of pictures and you stack them, and include your flats, those aircraft will no longer be there, because they're not within the averaging of your common picture. So I've actually.
Why is this particular person saying take the white balance and adjust it, and you're saying leave it auto?
Yeah, were you going to answer that, or I just had a question. So I have done it for scuba diving. Okay, where you go underwater and your white balance is different, so you can capture the true colors of the stuff that's underwater. Okay, it's the same thing for what's on land, but when you have white balance, your options on a camera for astrophotography are usually like tungsten, you know, cloudy stuff. Well, you're not, it's not cloudy conditions. We're not doing it under tungsten conditions. We're not doing it. So the two options that fit the camera best for this type of photography are either auto or sun. I think it's sun, right? Sun, solar, the options. It's as if you're doing it with the sun. Yeah. Oh, I let it decide. Well, you're, so I'm not sure dark sky is white balance.
If you're shooting camera raw,
it's not a white. Mm-hmm. You're taking a piece of a dark sky, setting that as your white balance, just an empty custom white dark sky.
Yeah.
Setting that as your custom white.
Do custom, yeah.
And then you take your picture.
I got it. Mm-hmm.
So white balance is only comes into play when you're making a JPEG. Right. You're shooting in camera raw. It doesn't matter.
Raw doesn't matter.
You can adjust it later on because it's close enough. You would impose a white balance in the process.
Yeah. And you'll find out that as you go through different temperatures, outside of auto or sun, I can't think of what the sun setting is.
Daylight,
whatever it is. Those just make the objects look the best and true. And it's just something that you discover through experience, I guess. Is there more questions? The bias.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
So the discussion was, do you have to do them every time or not? And you pointed out that you can just pick them quickly.
Yeah, so it's
lost the thread on why you wouldn't, the argument of, if there is one, of why you wouldn't take them every time.
Well, that's the flat frame, but if you're talking about bias, because you want to capture the bias at the time that the camera was being used, not later on. And quite frankly, you could snap off 10 shots in 10 seconds. So it's just worth doing.
Usually, I think it's the temperature of the overall system. The chips behave differently depending on the temperature. So the closest you are, for example, the bias is also reading the noise of the reading the chip into the memory. So the temperature should be the same, or as close as possible.
You know, what some people do and what I've actually done is, there's a couple nights that I've been out where I know, and I've been out there, you know, where it's 10 degrees or 17 degrees, and I signed the books going, where's everybody else? I thought you were real astronomers. So if I know that two nights in a row I was taking images for 2 hours at 17 degrees weather is back to back, I don't want to freeze my butt off the second night. I go, you know what, I took my darks and bias yesterday at sub-zero temperatures, I'm just going to keep the ones that I used yesterday. They're not going to move that much. But I got to, quite frankly, between today, where it's damp and wet, versus someplace dry and humid, or dry and warm in Arizona, you're going to get a whole different amount of noise. So,
just piggyback on his questions. When you take dark frames and flat frames, it doesn't have to be time similar to the light frame.
The darks do.
The darks do.
You got to take the darks for the same amount of time.
The light frame is about 30 seconds, and you have to take 30 seconds of that same.
Correct.
Time.
Yeah.
And you got to have 20 of them or whatever that you say.
Yeah, and but for something for 30 seconds, if you have a Nikon or a Canon, I can't speak to Olympus and Sony's, but I'm guessing they have it. They have something called long exposure noise reduction. That is taking a dark frame, and the camera just does it for you. So if you take a 30-second frame, it'll take a picture. You'll hear the shutter shut, and then the light goes back on for another 30 seconds, and it does a subtraction for you. So you can have the camera just do it for you. But once you get over 3 minutes, I got to tell you, when you're cold at night, I don't want to be taking each frame's 20 minutes or 10 minutes. I just want to take as many as I can. Take my darks afterward as I'm packing up and just go home. I mean, there you learn ways to cut corners when you're out there freezing.
Did the flats have to be the same time
as? No. So that's a misconception. You want the same ISO and in every other setting, but I will get into where you want your lights to be, or excuse me, your flats in a second. Can I continue on and ask save questions for later? Because I might be able to answer some questions with following. Okay, so real quick, I already know that this should answer your question. This is with an APO F7 5-inch. It's showing you how that quality is a function of time and ISO. So let me just get over here. This is probably going to clarify a lot of stuff. You can take a picture of an image at ISO 100, or excuse me, 12,800 for 1 minute, okay? But this is kind of what you're going to get in this corner here. You're going to get the image, but you're going to have all this noise, okay? But if you shoot the same image for, excuse me, ISO 400, don't forget, the lower the ISO, the longer you got an image for. We all know that, right? All right. So if you take an image, so for mine, which it should be close to yours for experimental, 400 at about 7.5 to 8 minutes gives me a shot that's going to look like this. I get the same image, but with a whole much more quality and less noise because there was no. I was able to do the dark frame, and the higher the ISO, you're collecting a whole lot more noise. I mean, it's collecting all this ambient light. It's amplifying what's already there, a little spark, and it's going to capture that. So you want to go to the lowest ISO possible. I could have went with something that was an ISO 200 or 100, but I could tell you it starts to taper off already over a period of time. I get no more benefit for 2 to 100 for this period of time. It begins to lift to a flatline here. So, yes. So these are some of your pros and cons. If you have a higher ISO setting, sure, you get the shorter exposure and you save on battery, but guess what? Less color depth, more color noise, which is what I was just trying to explain here. your lower ISO setting, more color depth, which really, I mean, if you look at this picture of the Orion Nebula, you'll see there's little shades of purple and blue and pinks and reds. If you go with a higher ISO setting, you're not going to capture that depth and detail. You're going to get something red, but you're really not going to get the little fine detail you will with lower ISO. The con is longer exposures, but I'm willing to do that. My battery life is reduced, fine. Noise from heat, I don't care because I'm going to do my dark frame subtraction to remove that heat noise. Are there any questions? Okay. Was it a hand raise? Okay. So hopefully this sticks. But remember I said you're going to want to start at 5 minutes. That's a good place to start. Let's just say I've taken my picture and you're wondering to yourself, what is that image on the back of my Nikon or the back of my Canon with this little bubble on histogram and RGB stuff and info? It kind of gets in the way. It's annoying. This is what you need to know. So as you are imaging, very important. So here's the image you just took. Now, if you look at my histogram, which you're going to see again in Photoshop in a moment, it is, if I blow it up, it is one, and starting in this second column of light capturing, if it gets, if you take your picture and it's here, your image will be too dark. This is how you know, am I taking the right exposure? If I expose something for 5 minutes and it ends up right here, you are golden. You are golden. If it's here, it's too dark. If it's here, you start to get overexposed and you're gonna have some object that's just white. It's just pure white. It's supposed to be pink, purple, and blue. Why is it white? And it's all this ambient light that's from, it's because you overexposed. So if you can, get it within the second frame, and that is where you're exposed. So that's very important for people that really want to get into astrophotography. You take your picture, and you're right here. So I have a little math question for the group. Let's just say I had an ISO setting of 400 for 5 minutes. 400 for 5 minutes, and my histogram was here. But I know that I need to get it, I move it here. What do I need to do? Come on, somebody step up. That's that, right. So all of a sudden you might find that it shifts here, okay? You know, I need to bring it back again. I either decrease my time or decrease the ISO to bring it back again. And that is how you do that. That's the magic. How am I on time? Okay, I should be done. Right? Okay, especially to this group. Okay. Okay, I just threw this up here, something called the auto guider. If you want to do subpixel imaging throughout the night on an object that's deep space, and you're going to want to image it for 2 hours, you're going to need what's called an auto guider. Now, there are some, if you're lucky enough, you got yourself a good mount, and you aligned it correctly, and everything's perfect, and you found Polaris, and you did all your homework, you might be able to track a deep space object for a couple hours with not a whole lot of errors. But my guess is that's not going to be the case because we're just imperfect. Plus, there's things called wind that get in the way that shake your mount. So what an auto guider does, in case you don't know, is, I just want to show it here. There's an auto guider port. It's right here on the mount. So if you're going to get an equatorial and you plan to do deep space imaging, you want to get one with an auto guider port. So what that does is you hook up a smaller telescope with the camera. Matter of fact, it could actually be this outfit right here. There is software that you basically, so if I'm going to take a picture of this nebula that's in the background, I select a star and like a heat-seeking missile, I lock onto it and it stays on it. It does some computations, some calculus, it calculates drift and things like that to stay on target. But if the telescope wobbles, the error correction is not good enough, the auto guider will, in an attempt to keep the star in the center, will make subpixel corrections to the mount to stay on target. So you always want to find a good star that is inside your nebula or your galaxy, lock on, and then rock and roll. Anything else? I think, are there any questions here?
How do you see it? How do you sleep still in low temperature?
Okay, so there's a couple ways to do it. This particular camera, it's a Celestron, but I'm not really endorsing this brand. There is, on the back of the camera, there's a live view mode. You can see a little star there. You can tell it to select this star, and there's like a little keypad, and you go lock onto this, and then you start your auto guiding, and it does it. And it does some computations and movements, but just go hands off, and it'll lock on. No, it's separate.
Okay. Yeah. So this is just for the
it's just to lock on to keep something in the center. That's on a separate scope. I would have a scope here, like, and then my auto guider would be on top of the main scope. So once you lock on, you set it to go. What part? Oh, if you don't have this rig that has the live view on the back, you can hook up a DSLR, and there's other types of cameras that have the video out that goes to software, and then there's different software packages that'll do it through software, and then you have a wire that runs back into here, so it's going from camera to your laptop. So you see some guys with the laptops out there, and they're doing their locking on there. I don't like to go that route. I just bought the unit that has the live view in the back of the camera. So yeah, there's just different ways to do it. What's the most popular one that you have for the laptops that push to PhD, which stands for push? Push her dummy. I just want to be the one to say that. Okay.
One other thing. When you want to move your camera, don't forget to turn your auto guider off.
Yeah. It can cause
it's
havoc.
Let me move my telescope with the auto guider.
I discovered that. So they don't put that into documentation, which gets into my into my later frames. Yeah, it tries to stay in charge and not your. Okay, so here's just something real quickly that I think is important if people are just getting started. So I took about 21 pictures of the Christmas tree cluster. I used Deep Sky Stacker. It's a free application. There's some other ones that are out there, and I stacked all my 21 images, and I took darks, and I took flats, and all that. And when you use Deep Sky Stacker, it actually, so you take all your videos and you transfer from your images and you transfer them to your laptop. Then once they're on your laptop, you run Deep Sky Stacker and it says, there's options, give me all of your light frames, and then you point to that directory and it brings them in. And then give me all your dark frames, and you do that, and flats and bias, and it asks you for each one in order, and you basically click go. And it starts chugging away, it starts to align, and then once it's all done, there's some options, but just give it a go as is, right out of the box, to see what happens. And what you end up with, it makes a TIFF image. Deep Sky Stacker will make a TIFF image that looks much like the picture you look right here. Now, you kind of see a bit of the Christmas tree here, and there's a whole cluster here, but you're just like, God, I took such great pictures. Why is it black and white? It just looks horrible. This isn't what, but keep playing around. Because you took RAWs, the data is actually still there and you have to bring it out now. So don't panic. Adjust a histogram. This is what's basically what people call stretching. What the heck's stretching? So what you want to do is you take the slider, you move it to the back of this, of your histogram that we saw earlier that was in your camera. Do you remember that? And then you want to move this from here to just before where there's some bumps right here. And the reason is, this is your dark area, but it also contains noise. It contains a lot of noise that doesn't have to be there. But usually at the beginning of these histograms, there's this little bump, and that bump is usually your nebulosity that you'll lose if you crop this right up to the right-hand side of this histogram. So you want to slide it over and slide it over, but don't go all the way from the front to the right. You just want to leave a little bit here, a little bit, and then click OK and see what happens. Now, some things are starting to come out here. So increase your vibrance and your saturation. So I have an answer for somebody that asked me this the last time. I didn't have a good answer, so I had to look it up. So this is where you increase your saturation, where it takes the red data that's in the picture in this case, and it begins to bring it forward. It makes the reds redder, oranges oranger. Your vibrancy, I found out, is software that is in your program that those that the software believes are already oversaturated enough, do not, it increases those background colors. Do you guys follow me on that? So if the software did, so it's almost like saturation, but if it already figures this is already oversaturated, but this part is not, it'll start to bring this into. So it helps to bring in some of that nebulosity that you wouldn't other be able to bring forward. And then after we click OK with this, so this is 40, you always make that 20. You'll start to figure out why. It'll start to come in clearer. So then there's the S-curve. So every application, software, book says make this thing called an S-curve to bring in your colors. Now, I don't know why it's not showing up here. Well, you can actually see it on the screen here. But in here, it's in the screen, but it's not here, is that histogram. It's actually right here. And if you create an S-curve, so this is your dark, this is where your black is, your brightness. Increase the brightness, you bring this down, and you get more contrast. And you'll see your picture as you're visually looking at it as you start to come in. And then you can work with the S to get it just right. You may think you're overcompensating, bring it back. So make an S-curve, play with that, and see what that happens. That's the curve histogram part, right? And then this starts to come in. Now, if you look here, please, somebody vouch for me. The picture looks pretty good here. Does not look good on here. This is also your... Okay. So this was the Christmas tree cluster. If I'm not mistaken, I also used a Lumicon deep sky filter because the majority of it is hydrogen alpha. So I was able to block out all this other light and really bring in the red because it is a red nebula. And then you increase the contrast and brightness. I usually... Oops, let me go back one here. I double my brightness for based on it's a 1-to-2 like ratio for contrast to brightness, and it really works for me. So I'm just giving these to you. See if they work for you. If not, you can still adjust them. And then I also ran a despeckle because I thought it was a little bit too speckled, and it did a good job. And then tweak from here. And that was the final. Looks better on there. Okay. So let's just jump into resources. I'll just get to these really quick. Lots of books out there. I basically have all these books. I've read these books. They are in my bedroom. I just read them all night. So,
you're taking the
dark fridge. Oh yeah, I'm just telling you this. So I pushed this book. It is the most all-encompassing books I have found for astronomy, and it also has pictures on astrophotography, astroimaging. And I found it to be the best book of all the books. I mean, they take great pictures, great explanations, and they actually will go into, if you have a Celestron mount, this is the setting. If you have a Skywatcher mount, you should use this setting. So they actually go into the different mounts. But the primary mount that I just lucked into is, the prime example for mounts was the Skywatcher. So this book helped me so much. It really did. But it's a very good book. If you can get we have it in our library at NOVAC. So if somebody hasn't taken it yet, you may want to get your hands on this book. Resources, really quick, just basically websites. NOVAC, one called Cloudy Nights, that's where everything is discussed. If you have any questions, a lot of astrophotographers throughout the world are there. Astromart is where people sell things, they barter. It's kind of like the swap table here. Facebook, lots of good stuff on Facebook. I have connected with astrophotographers from around the globe. And as funny as this may seem, I friended somebody who is a German who's living in Taiwan, and he is a world-renowned astrophotographer, and the Christmas tree nebula came up. And I said, you know what? From my side of the globe to yours, I challenge you to who could take the best picture. Now, we just did this for fun, okay? And he produced some of his best work. And I got to tell you, I was out there at 17 degrees, and I got some pretty good shots. So we exchanged pictures. But as we did this process, I asked him, what ISO did you use? What was your exposure length? What camera? And we were going back and forth, and I was learning. And he also learned from me. So those are good resources. Again, mentors. I couldn't have done this without clubs like NOVAC. And there's so many people here who are rich in information. Of course, Bob was... about 6 years ago, I posted on the NOVAC website. I just got this Skywatcher mount, and I literally posted, I go to Jupiter, which is over there, but it points at the ground. What's going on? And I went through the whole book again, and I said, okay, go to Jupiter now, pointed at the ground. I said, you know, I'm about to kick this thing. But before I do, let's put out a message. And Bob came over with, I think, a pizza and beer and soda, and we got it working, so thank you. Your colleagues at work, you know, I lucked into something too. I'm working in this in intelligence field, and it's probably the first place that I've ever worked where people who are sitting at the table with me are, like we talk about, we went to school, and they're physicists, and nuclear physicists from Berkeley and MIT, you know, they work at the national labs, and they really understand things like when we're talking about the hydrogen alpha and the excitement of the atom. So a lot of these guys were able to sit down, they got the whiteboard out, they worked out the equations, explained me all the math and science, and they love doing it because they're at desk jobs now, where at one time they used to go into the field in New Mexico and used to look for like radiation in tunnels. You know, they enjoyed getting out there and actually doing stuff. So they go out there with me and they help. Facebook, I mentioned there's Facebook's the guy from Germany. Another guy was Damien Peach. We all know who Damien Peach is, right? Everybody? Nobody? Somebody does, though. Right. So he's world-renowned astrophotographer. Even though he's excellent at deep space objects, he's probably the best at planets I've ever seen. Okay. So, you know, I just think this is funny, and I like to share this. One weekend, I was doing imaging. He actually caught and you can look this up online. He got a star going nova and a new star forming that wasn't there before in one weekend. I'm like, dude, my entire life, I can't do that, right? So, you know, and sometimes I'll write to him, hey, I'm going to be giving a lecture at the Mountain Institute this weekend, you know, on astrophotography. He goes, well, I'm just on my way back from Cambridge where I was giving a lecture there. And I said, okay. So, but, you know, a lot of these guys are willing to answer questions. So as long as they keep willing to say yes, keep asking questions. Yeah, the Smithsonian's, Bob and I had a chance to go out to the Smithsonian's, work with some people there. Universities, you have Professor Geller. People want to help you, believe it or not. People want to share their knowledge. They're just aching to share their knowledge, like I'm doing right now. So ask. So this is getting towards the end of the slides. I think this might be for Richard here. But
for a quick thing on Facebook, there's a really good Astro-imaging magazine.
Yeah. What's the name of it, you know?
I think Astro-imaging magazine, it might be.
Okay. Yeah, lots of resources. And especially with, you know, YouTube now, there's how-tos to even set up your mount. Lessons learned, patience. You will make mistakes. You will leave on a bat enough mask. You will forget something. You'll forget a plug. You'll forget something. You will break something and not have a spare or a tool to fix it. I actually have in my truck right now an electrical kit with a crimper in case I need to put on new connections, because I'm not going to drive all the way up here and they have my little thing break and then I'm stuck. So you will bump your scoper mount at some point. If not you, someone will do it for you, some kid. You will forget to take off your bat. So I'm giving you a warning. So you might get past the batting off mask. You will do everything right, but the technology will fail. There have been days when it was so cold or the humidity was so high that my mount misfunctioned. I actually remove this and I stick a hand warmer into the mount on cold days to just keep the electronics warm and functioning. But even so, last night I was doing some imaging. Bob was helping me. I was going through the whole rigmarole to do the three-star alignment on my telescope, and then I would take it to an object, it would point someplace else. I'm like, what's,
don't. Didn't figure out why.
Didn't figure out why. So we eventually got it to work, though, because we went from a three-star alignment to just a one-star, and then it was fine. So something happened that night where the three-star alignment didn't work, so we had to use just a one-star, and it was fine. But whatever. Wind will blow, we know that. Dual form, last night. The ground will shake. Well, cars drive by. Yeah, it happens. Car lights will flash. People who are coming in after hours because they left work too late for, you know. People will come up with flashlights. Now, most of you are professional or you're astronomers, so you know. But if you do a public night someplace, kids walk around their flashlights, look down the tube, stuff like that. So you have to remind them not to just to use the red lights or don't. Aircraft and satellites will fly through. If you do this long enough, you will capture satellites. I mean, you're going to capture an inordinate amount of satellites and airplanes. But don't give up, because I was talking, I think it was to Keith, about this. It's like golf. And you too, Richard. It's like golf. Once you get good and you got a picture, like, oh, I'm going to keep this up. I was about to throw my golf clubs in the lake. But now I'm not because I'm doing a good game. So when you start to get into it, it becomes fun. Don't give up. Why? Because this is what's next, or is what's next for me at least, is this is starting to come into the mainstream a little bit more. There's something called high dynamic range astroimaging. Now, high dynamic range was always there, okay? But I'm beginning to see more of it. So this, almost cartoony, but look at this rich color of HDR astroimaging. So if you don't know what that is, that's where you take a series of light frames of something, but they're underexposed. Then you take a series of frames that are exposed perfectly, and then you take one that are actually overexposed. Now, some cameras can combine this inside the camera, or you can get software for it, but what it does is it creates a larger dynamic range from under to overexposed, and you get these rich pictures like you see right here. Now, that's great, so I'm going to try that while I'm up here. It's my first time, so we'll see what happens. The last thing, I have tried this. I have gotten some results, but I have not perfected it yet. Something called the Hubble palette, where you combine I had mentioned the mono camera where you take RGBs separately, but the way Hubble does it, in case you don't know, is when Hubble looks at the universe, it uses sulfur 2 for its red, because sulfur 2, when it's ionized, it emits in the red spectrum. Green is hydrogen alpha, and O3 is going to be your blue. So you take all these pictures, you take about 21 of these, 21 of those, or 21 of those, or 10 of each or something, and then you combine them all separately. So you get something that actually looks like this, something that rich, that looks like a Hubble picture. And you could do it right here from ground if you've got the patience. So I've dabbled in this, I've had some results, but I want to start to get into this. And that should conclude. Thank you. But if you have any questions, go ahead. Thank you. Thank you. Okay, I have had a couple, okay, but I have airplanes flying through more often than lightning bugs. But again, if you take a bunch of lights and flat, I'm not even sure about if you take enough lights and you average them or you do a median, you'll get rid of it. So, go on. So, when you take a median, I don't want to get too advanced, but I'm going to try my best to make it simple in my brain. When you take 20 pictures, you can take all the pictures and take what's right in the middle, and that's called the average. And so it's going to take everything and stack them towards that middle. Then there's a median, which is almost like an average, which goes to one side or the other, depending on how many. Once you start stacking and you're doing this median of, if there's a star in the same spot, which we know there is because we're taking great pictures, okay, as you process the median, that star is in every picture. So it takes the median of the brightness of that star and it makes it into one picture for you, okay? If there's a lightning bug, that's a one-off. If it's in one frame or two frames, but it's not in the rest, it gets lost, it gets washed out. So that's when you use these software programs like Deep Sky Stacker, they'll do that for you. And you know, it's kind of hard to explain it without showing you the software, but it's not hard. And it allows you, what type of stacking do you want to do? There's this sigma stacking, kappa. There's different choices. And then you can look online, like what the benefit is. Yeah, but median seems to work perfectly for me for all my pictures. Everything you saw here was median. And they'll wash out those light bugs for you.
Yeah. So when you're taking an average of a measurement, and that's true for anything in statistics, right? You're trying to find the center and get rid of the variance that can happen from one side or the other. When you have the one friend that has a bug, that guy is way over there.
He's outside the norm.
He holds the average significantly. And when you do a median, the median means find a spot where half the light is brighter, half the friend have more light than this, and half the frames have less light. And when there's a one frame that is way over there, it's just one frame still. So its effect is much reduced, and it basically disappears from the image.
And when Peter Goral talks about media photography, he's going to use the same mathematical concept flipped around. Most of his frames are all the same. He doesn't care about those. He only cares about the ones that have media. So he keeps the one which is the outline. He also keeps all the airplanes and all the satellites. But he knows what they are. But the mathematical approach is the same when it works.
The other option is just don't use that, right?
I just never mentioned that, and I probably should have, because that is a beginner portion of Azure. The reason you take 21, if you can, take 30. Because I guarantee you there'll be five or six where there's a little bit of shaking. There's an airplane. In fact, even before I get home, I go through my camera and I look for any pictures that aren't really perfect. I just delete. Then I've got the top 20, 21 or whatever, and I stack those. I mean, you could stack eight, but 21 light frames will give you the best performance. So this normally is, this is your black point, and you're moving it up, but it's getting rid of all this. So then you want to keep a little bit here, because often that's the nebulosity. So you're making it darker and darker and darker, but as you're making it darker, as you're going right, this starts to disappear, this kind of nebulosity. So you want to leave a little bit of a smudge. Is it here? So you're saying you don't want to go too far?
To the left.
Here, yes. Yeah, so that's why you want to get rid of those. But you don't want to go right up, because often these anomalous pixels start to get into the nebulosity realm.
No, they're bad pixels. They're not. The nebulosity is giving you a little bit of brightness above the dark peak. So it's the shoulder on the light.
Usually, my knowledge, I'm going to be with you and cross check, but the nebulosity is really the bump under the descending side.
Let's remember what a histogram is, first of all. It shows you how many pixels, the height is how many pixels are of that brightness. So if you have no black, totally black pixels, then there'll be no items in the black column. If you have no totally white pixels, there'll be nothing in the far right-hand column. In the center here, where that bump is, it's telling you that there's a lot of pixels that have the brightness of that center peak.
Yeah, right.
And so if you start taking and moving that carrot at the end there into where you have data, you're losing data, and you're losing the nebulosity that you like.
You know what? I think this is the way that I should have explained it. And Bob, you're absolutely right. So if you look here, that's what I'm doing, is this was once over here. It was at 1.21, but means 1.0 would have been someplace in the middle here. So you want to get rid of this. You want to start to move it over, so you do keep some of the nebulosity. But if I'm not mistaken, there's still a little bit recorded right up here in the front. Okay, so I think the safe thing is, like you just said, you're going to want to bring both of these ends in. So that's the safe thing that we want to do, is bring in both ends, but still leave a little bit of gap on each sides, just in case there's stuff you don't want to lose.
In my experience, when you stuck very noisy picture, you don't have any bump on the left side unless you stuck after the stuck.
Mm-hmm.
And usually, this is the noise you go to start.
But you want to take the images long enough so that bump is moved away from that black point.
Yeah.
That's how you do that. one of the ways you determine how long your image should be. You want to move that histogram away from the total left-hand side so that you have at least some total black that you can then get rid of.
Yeah. So you just want to get rid of junk up here and junk back right there. That's the bottom line to all that. Any other questions? Okay.
Let's thank John again.
I'll catch you afterward. Thank you. Thank you.
This morning we talked about.
I think they will. Well, yeah, sure.
Is organizing.